played, but as we moved on, a simple memorial meeting has turned out to be a really powerful seminar which will linger on for a long time for those who are already initiated with the historical discourses and also those who are reintroduced or initiated today itself. Let me therefore invite Prof. Mridula Mukherjee, who has been, as you know, has been not just our teacher but has been leading a kind of forceful intervention for the last almost two decades, particularly in the recent form from 2000 onwards, but in the earlier avatar in 1970s when the books, textbooks were banned in 1977. And therefore, not only that historically she is placed in this debate, but also as from a position of history writing from scientific, secular, rational, whatever you call it, a major intervention, major force to reckon with. Professor Mridula Mukherjee.
Thank you, Rakesh. I am very grateful to the Center for Historical Studies for this opportunity to share with you my perspective on Professor Satish Chandra, whose departure has left a void which is very difficult to fill. As most of the speakers who have spoken before you today have said, that it is particularly at this point at which we are located in our political life that we feel his absence very keenly. He remained till the end very concerned about and very active in voicing his concerns and fears and opinions about what was going on around him. He was never, despite his illness and failing health, never cut off from what was going on at all. Very, very, I think the most wonderful thing about his life, particularly in the last years, was how alert he was. I had the opportunity, I'm not a medieval history scholar, so I was never a direct student of his, but I was very much a student in the center when he was the first dean of our school in 71 when I joined as an MPhil student. So I very much, it was a small center, relationships between students and teachers were very cordial, and I had the good fortune to invite him to a college in which I also started teaching, Ranabir College, to come and give a talk over there. And I was just a young student and just started teaching. And I went up to him and I said, "Sir, will you come and give a talk in my college?" And he said, "Sure." And you know, this was, and I think by the time he came, he was already been appointed vice chairman of the UGC and all that. But he had no airs about him. He was extremely approachable, very nice to young people. In fact, all the culture of the center, of which I think many of you here who are students of the CHS are beneficiaries and participants and also carriers. The democratic culture of the center and the university. And he was very much a part of that and contributed to that. As speakers before me have made explicit, Professor Irfan Habib in fact said that they were both party members. And he was talking about the 50s, you know. And this was the United Communist Party of India in its glorious days, when the best intellectuals, the best artists, the best in every field used to be attracted towards the leftist ideology and the party that represented it. Satish Chandra was very much a product of that. We often take a culture and that those times. We tend to forget that because later he occupied very high positions within the government, chairman of the UGC, and as Bhambri I think reminded us very well, we tend to forget that part of his life, his activist, political activist part, where he was the first head of the teachers' association, you know, secretary of the Indian history, Congress, etc., etc. So it's a remarkable life. It's a multifaceted where, again, as Irfan Sahab reminded us, what he learned from him was that though you may be an activist, though you may be a dissenter, a radical, you do not shirk your responsibilities in the university. That assuming responsibilities, or whether it's provost or proctor or dean or whatever, if they do come your way when it's your due, which is not so normal these days, you do not shirk them, you take them on. And that was a tradition of our center as well, that the very, very radical faculty which loved to dissent all the time with everybody, including the best vice chancellors, and yet they always served their administrative terms when they came. Another very interesting and important aspect, I think, which I want to share with the students about the quality of Professor Satish Chandra's scholarship, which I want to make a point of emphasizing, which has emerged in all the discussion that you've heard so far. But it's becoming rare these days, and therefore I want to just emphasize it, underline it. You know, his mastery over the language of the sources, his mastery over the sources, his wide reading, not just in his own specialization, that is the 17th or 18th century, not just in the whole of the medieval period, but in all periods of Indian history, in fact, reading the history of all countries of the world, and a broad awareness, you know, of other disciplines, of all that going on around you. I think that is something I would like to emphasize, because somewhere I find, while there is still often a lot of radicalism, there's political awareness, but the hard work that needs to go with it, and the dogged sort of boring archival work that needs to go with it, the hours that have to be spent learning your Persian and Sanskrit and Gujarati or Marathi, whatever it is, you know, and all that somewhere seems to be lacking. I want to emphasize, you do not become a Satish Chandra without having done that solid work. It's that which guides, it's that core on which you can grow later. The rest comes later, the flower comes later. But if you do not have that solid core, you will always remain somewhere floating here and there without your own moorings to hang on. And that brings me to the two things that I, one of the two things which I'm going to talk about very briefly. I'm not going to repeat so many of the very, very perceptive aspects which have been pointed out so far, including Indian Ocean Studies, which already did so wonderfully. But I want to just talk about the fact that Satish Saab was a very good example of the very solid Indian Marxist historical tradition, of which you have many representatives in this center as well as outside, Professor Lien Jha, Professor Arish Sharma, and many others, who, while remaining squarely within that tradition, yet remained independent of any hegemonic ideas that may have come from Western Marxist tradition. This does not mean that they didn't converse with or did not know or did not study all that came from the Western sources, including the Western Marxist tradition. But they were not hegemonized by it. Whether it was within the political circles, the ideas of R.P. Dutt, or whether it was Marx himself when it comes to the whole issue of the Asiatic mode of production. In fact, to me, the rejection of the Asiatic mode of production by almost all the Indian Marxist scholars, from Irfan Habib to Satish Chandra to Bipin Chandra, who wrote a whole long essay on it, and scholars from ancient India, I think is a very good example of how independent it was not surviving in any way. It did not accept the Eurocentric presumptions of the Western Marxist tradition, whether it is Eric Hobsbawm or whoever, and yet had no difficulty in engaging with it, but on equal. course, Satish Sahab was not one to get easily swayed or buffeted by lighter winds like postmodernism and all that. Again, it doesn't mean that he was not conversant with it. I want to emphasize that here was somebody who had the opportunity to be at the heart of Western, the most high table of Western academia. As somebody mentioned before me, in Paris at the Maison, he was part of its highest body for a very long time. As chairman of the UGC, he dealt with all these people on a daily basis, and he could have had any positions or whatever that he wanted for the ISK, and catered to the positions, the intellectual positions that were propounded in these centers. And yet you find there is no sign of that. He remains absolutely solid and squarely and confidently located in his own moorings of the Aligarh school, the Allahabad school, Indian Marxist tradition, while dealing with complete ease with all of them. I think this is true cosmopolitanism. Cosmopolitanism is not when you get swayed by the flavor of the month, influences coming from whichever is the most powerful center of academia today, where you might get a fellowship or you might not, or you might get a visiting professorship or not. You know, I think cosmopolitanism is that you are deeply rooted in your own moorings, and yet you can engage meaningfully with all that emanates from anywhere in the world, no matter from what source that might be. And that comes through very spirit. In fact, if you just look at the essays which he writes on historiography, as I was looking at the other day, it is amazing. His range of familiarity with world history, with trends in world history, is quite extraordinary. His ability to understand where they come from, what are the social and political and economic sort of deeper stories within Western society from which they emerge. And then he says, but this is, for us, this means something different. For us, nationalism still means something different. He's able to say that. He's able to understand and yet distance himself from those traits. The second thing which I want to talk about is also part of the section in which I'm speaking, is on his understanding of secularism. We've already mentioned that he was a very doughty fighter for the cause of secularism and against all kinds of communal ideas in the writing of history. In fact, I want to point out that in his writings he took head-on Jagannath Sarkar's very, very dominant understanding of Aurangzeb's the decline of the Mughal Empire being located in Aurangzeb's religious policy. And that was dominant. Five volumes, Jagannath Sarkar had written, the doyen of Indian historians. And Satish Sahab takes it on frontally and point by point argues how Aurangzeb's religious policies were not the cause. He argues how Aurangzeb, in fact, was not just prompted by religious considerations, and goes to great lengths to make these points in various essays. Again, you can see in that a combination of the academic and political concerns which he had, which he joined. He could see that this was a major argument that needed to be made. The person who has to write an article in the newspaper, who has to answer a question in a public meeting, needed this material to be able to answer why Aurangzeb was not a bigoted ruler and why we didn't have to go around changing roads, the names of roads, and getting to the whole thing of a good Muslim and a bad Muslim. You know, there are no good Hindus and bad Hindus. All Hindus are good. But when it comes to Muslims, we have to ask, are you a good Muslim, are you a bad Muslim? If you're a bad Muslim, the road should not continue to be named after you. We'll find a good Muslim and name the road after that good Muslim. Right? So you can't feel bad. You can't say I'm criminal that I've changed the name of the road because I found a good Muslim and I named after you. These are all these serious ideas, you know. how we knew all this very well. So it's not just a question of defending Aurangzeb, as one is sometimes told, why do you have to go around defending every Mughal ruler? It's not that. It's a question about wider questions of historiography that are important over here, and these issues in historiography affect our daily politics today, every day. It's the bread and butter of the politics in which we are living. So I'd like to draw your attention to a very interesting paper which he wrote on the Indian National Movement and the concept of secularism, which he wrote in 1987. And in this he examines at great length how precisely the idea of secularism was articulated by the leaders of the freedom struggle. And he argues that it was primarily a means of keeping the country united despite differences of religion, language, race, etc. This postulated a certain distance between secular power and the religious leaders, broad toleration to those professing different religions and speaking different languages, and a ruling class drawn as far as possible from diverse settings. So this is how he defined the three elements of what he thought constituted Indian secularism in the ideas of the nationalist leaders. But what is fantastic is that then he goes on to show how this formulation of secularism, which was made by the nationalist leadership, was a continuation of the pre-colonial Indian tradition. And the evidence he gives to support his proposition is from the time of the ruler who was supposed to be the least secular of the Mughals, that is Aurangzeb. And I will quote to you a few sentences, because if I say it in my own words, it will not have the same impact. What Satish Chandra says is the following, I quote, "These conditions of what constituted secularism, that is, distance between secular power and its leaders, broad toleration of those professing different religions and speaking different languages, and a ruling class drawn as far as possible from different segments. These three conditions," he says, "were fully replicated during the Mughal period." This is indeed revolutionary, locating the secular tradition squarely back in the Mughal period and back to in the period of Aurangzeb. Even an orthodox ruler, he says, such as Aurangzeb, could not deny broad religious toleration to the people on the basis of the Quranic injunction, "To you your religion, to me mine." He also rejected the concept of dismissing Hindus from the services. I'm continuing to quote him. "Recent study shows that the proportion of Hindus, including Rajputs and Marathas, rose from 24% under Shah Jahan to 33% during the latter part of Aurangzeb's reign." We know this is the work of Professor Akbaran, which is referring to here. I continue to quote, "Nor did Aurangzeb allow the clergy to interfere in political affairs, though he sometimes used clergymen to further his political objectives. Thus, a de facto separation of political authority from religion and a distance between the secular and the ecclesiastical authority was a part of the Indian tradition." He then goes on to say, "This may explain why the Western concept of secularism, that is separation of the state from religion, found ready acceptance as long as it did not affect the practice of religion as such in India." You can see how he's in a way standing the whole discussion on its head by not saying that the whole secular idea has come from Western sources. You may find glimmerings earlier. In fact, the language which he uses, that he says, I was very, very struck by this, when he says that these conditions, he says, were fully replicated during the Mughal period. And he's not even talking about Akbar. He's not talking about Zainab, he's not talking about Akbar's very radical pronouncements on various issues, including the position of women and all that, which has later come to light, which many historians now argue about. So I thought that it was very important that we go back and look at the writings of our very prominent scholars, many of whom, I'm sad to say, are no longer in our reading lists. We do not even go back to these books because we think that they are outdated and something more fashionable and contemporary is more important, but there are still a wealth of material and a wealth of insights and understanding which you may not find in some of the more contemporary works. I was also very struck by the fact that you had a very positive understanding of the role of Mahatma Gandhi. Again, this to me was an example of the independent mind. Many of our Marxist scholars, Professor Divya Tiwari, Professor Irfan Habib, Professor Satish Chandra, have rejected the more dogmatic Marxist understanding of Gandhi, where Gandhi has been seen as a bourgeois mascot, etc. And in this same article that I was referring to earlier, in fact, he says that Gandhiji's advocacy of reform, social reforms, ameliorating the position of women, especially women's education, etc., abolition of parda, widowly marriage, and his denunciation of untouchability as a sin began a new chapter in the struggle for a just and a rational society. Despite limitations, the long-range repercussions of Gandhi's support for social reform should not be underestimated. Not only was he able to effect a wide stirring of social opinion, he was able to effectively isolate the orthodox elements among the Hindus. The reform of Hindu society by legislation after independence would have been impossible but for these two conditions. This was an exact quote from Satish Chandra. He also goes on to say that the Karachi resolution, which was passed in 1931 by the Congress, which for the first time spelled out fundamental rights that would be guaranteed to the Indian people, in which the right to practice religion, protection to minorities, all these things are spelled out very clearly over there. Gandhiji, when he was introducing the fundamental rights resolution to the public, made the following statement, which Satish Chandra quotes with great approval. He says, Gandhiji said, I quote, "Swaraj will favor Hinduism no more than Islam, nor Islam more than Hinduism. But in order that we may have a state based on religious neutrality, let us from now on adopt this principle in our daily affairs." This fundamental rights resolution, Gandhiji said, is meant to indicate to the poor, inarticulate Indian the broad features of Swaraj or Ram Raj. Again, making it very clear that for Gandhiji, Ram Raj and Swaraj were the same. Ram Raj was not Hindu Raj. It was just a good government, a just society. Again, he quotes with great approval a quotation from Gandhiji in 1946 on the issue of the relationship between state and religion. On 22nd September 1946, Gandhiji, writing in the Harijan, Satish Chandra said, I quote, "I swear by my religion, I will die for it, but it is my personal affair. The state has nothing to do with it. The state will look after your secular welfare, health, communication, foreign relations, currency, and so on, but not my religion. That is everybody's personal concern." So in this essay, which I think is in many ways very, very radical, very advanced, very ahead of time in many ways, he spells, and he's not a scholar of modern India, he spells out with great length and with great complexity, you know, the particular Indian understanding of the concept of secularism, locates its pre-colonial roots, talks about how it develops, its linkages with the British education policy, etc., etc., and then gives us these very, very interesting nuggets from some of the writings of the nationalist leaders. I'll leave you with that. Thank you.